Welcome to Hopkinton Coffee Break, your home for current community talk with Patricia Duart, Darlene Hayes, and Connie Wright.
Hello, welcome to Hopkinton Coffee Break. We haven't been together. We're just coming back from hiatus, and what a perfect time to have the superintendent of Hopkinton Public Schools, Dr. Carol Cavanaugh. Thank you for taking time out of what must be a busy morning and every day for you.
Well, thank you for having
me. To chat with us for a few minutes. It's our first time meeting you.
Yes. Exactly. So thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be on the show.
Absolutely.
Back to school. Back to school.
Back to school.
Yeah. Yes.
And I was saying that, we are now women sitting here with no kids in school. So we're just, it's awesome to just meet you and understand what's happening.
Well, I like it because I do feel a little disconnected. And I feel like the schools really is part of the backbone or the fabric of a community. So when I'm not, no longer having any children in the school system, so it's great to meet you. It's like, oh, okay, I'm going to meet you otherwise.
Exactly.
But you're not new to Hopkinton, though. For the school system?
No, I was here as the assistant superintendent. I'm really starting my third year in the district.
Right. Wow. Yeah. So did you come to Hopkinton as an assistant superintendent
a
few years ago?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, Carol, tell us a little bit about yourself in terms of
where'd you grow up?
And however much background you want to share.
Sure. So I have never actually left Massachusetts in terms of where I've lived, right?
Okay.
So I grew up in Shrewsbury.
Oh, okay. Cool.
I still live in Shrewsbury, where I raised my three children. Mm-hmm. They are 28, 26, and 24.
Well, you had your hands full, but what wonderful age is that?
And you had a big summer event with one of your kids this summer.
I did, yes. Yeah. So my oldest got married in July.
Oh, congratulations!
Yeah, really great.
Now, daughter or son?
Daughter.
Okay,
yeah.
So
it's totally different, right?
I'm about to have my oldest get married in the spring, but mm-hmm. I'm mother of the groom, so a little less involved.
So you know the wear beige rule. Right.
Oh, yeah.
No, there's no white.
I think
they're
green.
What you'll be doing, this is my baby.
So you had a wedding this summer with your oldest.
Yeah, it was
wonderful.
Great.
But back to your three kids raised in Shrewsbury, and
yes.
then where'd you go to school and all that good stuff?
So as an undergraduate, I went to BU, mm-hmm. and then I got my master's at BU and my doctorate at Lesley.
Wow. So always knew you wanted to be in education, or...?
No, I had no idea I would end up in education. At BU, I was an English major and a Latin minor.
Okay.
And when I got out of school, I realized that there were really no marketable skills
there.
There
was a big draw for Latin people.
Hey,
right?
I
was a studies major.
I was an English major. It works out eventually.
Like, what do you do with that?
I know. The joke used to be wait tables, right?
Yeah.
So, it was actually my mother who had found an ad in the paper to teach at a private school in Massachusetts,
mm-hmm.
and so that's what I started doing,
loved
it immediately. I was at, now it's called Trinity Catholic Academy
mm-hmm.
in Southbridge. Yeah, so I spent a year there, and then I decided that I should just go back to BU and get an MAT,
mm-hmm.
a teaching certificate, and the rest is sort of history.
That's
so when you taught, did you taught in the upper grades or elementary level?
High school.
Oh, yeah,
yes.
There you go.
Yeah.
Awesome.
And I think I taught pretty much everything from, those sort of fundamental classes where your goal is to get kids to have a competency determination and mm-hmm. all the way to AP Lit. So,
cool.
Yeah, it was good.
I started off
really
as an early education major. Then when I had to do my winter co-op thing.
Yes.
I went back and changed majors.
She was around little kids, right?
Right. The school I went to, they didn't want you to declare a major, I did. And so if you did, they want you to do something in the winter to do that major, see if you really like it before you commit too much time.
Mm-hmm.
I got assigned to a school in the town I grew up with, then assigned to the same first grade teacher and kids I babysat for in my own community. And I'm like, it's babysitting. But even now, I'm still drawn to want to get a certificate to maybe teach
mm-hmm.
like a specialized course or things like that, like mm-hmm. Jim is doing at the high school.
Yes. Oh, yeah, that's great.
I had an opportunity to sub at the Hopkinton schools for a couple of
mm-hmm.
years when I was transitioning from corporate to, my business, and loved it. And I worked, I was the on-call, I said, you can call me at 6 in the morning, I'll be there, middle school and high school. My kids were of that age, and I just, really loved that age.
Did you ever get them in class?
I only once. I did art. I was like a resident sub for the art
mm-hmm.
department in the high school, which was wonderful. But I didn't somehow. I think briefly, Evan was in a computer class, kind of rotation, that particular moment, but not usually. And I don't know if it was by design, it just didn't work, you know. But I saw him in the halls, it was awesome. It was great.
So schools, you know, you kind of grew up in the area, and you've been in the Hopkinton School District now. Mm-hmm. This is entering your third year. We've had a brand new elementary school open, but lots going on. Tell us about, you know,
what's it like
day in the life?
A day in the life is actually very busy. Opening marathon has been amazing.
I was at the ribbon cutting. It was.
Oh, yeah.
And there's like hidden Mickeys in there.
Yeah.
Like if you go to Disney, that are hidden things, treasures that are in the floor and in embedded that are actually things on the marathon or history of Hopkinton hidden in there that you can find.
Oh,
that's
fun.
Cute.
I've
been there.
Wasn't around when the ribbon cutting, but I would love a tour. One of these, I'm sure there'll be like a, is there going to be an open to the public day or was
well,
that it?
That was the day in the summer.
Yeah. But I would imagine that you
can
arrange
get
to get
business.
In there.
Yeah.
You know,
talk to the principal.
Somebody's little kid.
But in the flooring, you know, as Darlene was saying, there's, you know, some really neat kind of, you know, artwork there. So there's a cruise shell because it kind of goes along the Charles River.
Uh-huh.
And when we had a kindergarten night, the kids actually sat on the floor and pretended to row.
Wow.
I mean, you don't, I guess, expect them to be that aware of what's in their surroundings,
cute.
But I thought that was a really neat thing.
That is awesome. So what's it like being at the helm, you know, now the superintendent now and you know, in terms of what's on your mind as a
So in my interview
leader,
process, this is a little bit comical maybe, but I think in the back of your mind you always have sort of like Fox News, right?
Mm-hmm,
I mean, you always
mm-hmm.
have to be in that place
yes.
where you know that kids are safe. And
yeah.
so that's really your first priority,
mm-hmm,
I mean,
mm-hmm.
despite the fact that there's, like, I think a lot of, like, PR to the job, you know, a lot of parent calls and those kinds of things that you're always fielding. So, for example, right now, transportation seems to be a big issue.
Okay. Always is at the beginning of the school year.
Yeah.
And
well, I mean,
that
and
might
and
be just
the first
it,
Heller
right?
Day. I know this airs tonight, but today's the first Heller
Day. Oh, my
God. between the high school kids coming in later and then people dropping off for Hopkins, it's like, you can't get up and down.
I never.
We didn't have Hillary.
That's a different story.
But between the buses and the drop-offs, yeah, transportation.
And
so what's the big issue?
The
like not
run.
Enough, or what's the issue with the transportation?
Oh, I think it just takes a while for us to figure
the
timing out.
Yeah. Okay.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So
the pickup and drop-off is new this year.
At the high school.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, I have to tell you. In the summertime, we met with the DPW, the engineer from World Tech, the police department, the crossing guards. You know, we kept having all of these meetings. And the more I looked at those drawings, the more I kept thinking, this is never going to work. It's going to be a disaster.
Right.
And the first day we got out there, and, you know, everybody sort of had a role out there, and we moved the traffic through. And I can tell you that Hayden Row, by and large, this year is so much clearer than
oh,
it
good.
Ever has
oh,
been.
Really?
Okay.
It's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
That's awesome.
And, you know, when you kind of queue up at the front door of the high school,
mm-hmm.
it used to be that there would be, you know, a dozen cars there, and then
sure.
they would back all the way down
yes,
to Hayden Row.
Yes.
This year, you can go in there, and there may be three or four cars. They just keep moving.
Oh, wow.
It's astounding. So I did have to call the engineer and say, I take back everything I whispered all summer.
You're right. Design and everything else.
Well,
awesome.
You know, it is hard. And, of course, we've added now another school on Hayden Row. And so it's kind of like, it. Hopefully it'll stop people that are looking at traffic and hopefully Waze, you know, and at 495 to the Pike and using 85 as a cut through, because that was the other part of the problem was we had all this traffic being diverted through Hopkinton. Maybe it'll
mm-hmm.
prevent it.
I like that the new elementary school's on Hayden Row, and I actually really like the location. I mean, I would love Elmwood School to move that way, too. I like that it feels
it's
like
a campus.
Mm-hmm. That it's a real campus feel, that emergency people can get there until basically any of the schools in seconds. You can get there in seconds if you need to be.
Mm-hmm.
And there have been times where we've had to have those situations, and I think I like that feeling. And even though I don't have kids in the school now, mine is just recent. My last one just graduated.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I mean, I had to do the obligatory, still even in college, first day of school
she
pictures.
She does it for both her kids, and her son's a senior in college.
Well, you know what the cool thing is that when you put that up, and that the president of the your daughter's college actually likes the photo.
Oh, that's cute.
That's great.
And stuff. But I like that. I think it builds a tighter community with everyone close to. I know that when my daughter was doing her Gold Award, the kids were coming from Hopkins, and so she went with like another person. They wouldn't pick the kids up. They'd walk them over there, and then pick up would be at the high school. That it made that very doable
it's
for them.
It's a nice complex building.
Yeah, it is.
So transportation's on your mind. What else do you think about as far as looking on the horizon?
I would say the biggest issue that the Hopkinton Public Schools will have is student enrollment. So in January of 2018, so this past January, we had already exceeded the number that NSDEC predicted for this fall. In the last year, we've had 189 new students join us.
Wow.
The number now is 3,721, which NSDEC predicted for us in 2024.
So are there pockets of kids coming in certain age groups, or is it spread through?
No, that's actually a very interesting question. We have 59 new students in kindergarten, so they predicted that we would be at 202, and we are at 261.
Okay.
So that's a very logical place for kids to land,
right,
because parents want the K-12 experience. The other big number we have is 25 kids in grade 6.
Okay.
Wow.
So,
yeah.
And I think that's just because people want the secondary experience.
That's what we came.
And exactly, right? So then the other big number is that if we combine grades 8 and grade 9, because people are prepping for sort of their high school experience, there are 25 students in those two grades combined who are also new.
So in four grades, basically,
the bulk
you've got the big pocket of it,
Those 180
is really grades out of 12.
Are in those
12.
Four grades,
That's huge.
Interesting.
The concern for us, I think, is when you have that many new students, you have to think about busing them, which is an enormous cost, special education, which is a big cost. But I think the biggest cost of all will be physical plants, because it won't be long before we outgrow all of the buildings that we have.
Wow.
I mean, 2 years we could be outgrowing those buildings, and we have no plan in place right now to do something with those physical plants. So we have to think very hard about that.
So what is our average classroom size right now in the various, you know, I know it varies, but, you know, where are we?
There are pockets of big.
Yeah.
So, for example, at the high school social studies classes, there are some that are 28s and 29s. Mm-hmm. Math classes at the high school are in that same range, depending on the level of math. We, at school committee last night, we sought out two new teachers, two FTEs, in the middle school, sixth grade, to sort of compensate for that number of 25, which brings those numbers down to 21 and 23.
Okay.
But I don't think we can be naive enough to think that we won't have any sixth graders join us through the school year.
Right,
so
right.
I would say that those will probably bubble to anywhere between 23 and 25 during the school year, if we had to make a prediction about that. It's just a guess.
Wow. No, for the first week of school, and even though my kids are in college, I did ask about class size on both of them each time. And both have said that they have less kids in their classes in college than they did in Hopkinton, which is kind of, you know, I mean, both are in a very minute kind of honors programs, but they still have to take some general ed. And I mean, my daughter said in her general ed for something, there were 22 kids in it.
Well, but on a national average, I would say you know, and this has been years and years, but I do remember you wanted fewer students in your K through six, and then, you know, it goes up a little bit, but I, you know, we're maybe in the lower grades a little higher, but in the upper grades, you know, certainly we're not extraordinarily tight.
Sure, and I think if
we're
not
city.
This is just, go ahead.
Well, I think if you went on the DESE website and looked at teacher-student ratio for the high school, the numbers would look very good. And sometimes that happens because, you know, there's a specialized art class where we have 14 students.
Right,
right.
But then you also have a math class where you have 30.
Right.
Having been a high school teacher for a very long time, I can say that in honors level courses at, you know, the high school level, you know, typically those will get a little bit full, but it's because, you know, kids are very much invested and they keep working.
And you can handle, you know, when you're in an honors program, there's an expectation.
They also don't need as much hand-holding in the class.
Exactly.
You know, I mean, they're very
self-motivated.
But what about K through 6? How are the numbers looking?
Well, in kindergarten, when we began the budget process last year, and by the time we were, I don't know, around May, we thought we would have kindergarten classes, 11 of them, and that the numbers would be very low, like maybe 18 in a class. And we were encouraged to you know, even reduce the number of classrooms because 18 was such a low number. And we're thankful that we didn't, mm-hmm. because now we are up to 13 classes and there are 21 kids in every one of those
wow.
classes.
Wow.
So,
exactly.
Yeah. The
that's
numbers
a,
have been enormous.
That's a lot
enormous.
Of kids.
That's a lot of kids, yeah.
So, of course, the kids being the focus, but as a superintendent, you're also overseeing a workforce. Just
yes,
curious.
What, absolutely.
What's the
number
of employees?
Yeah.
I mean, faculty, you know, admin.
Support services,
just broad,
everything.
You know, yeah. That's
yeah.
A, it's a big
well,
operation.
Probably about 500.
Yeah.
I know.
That's a big number.
Yeah.
That's a big thing if you just realized, outside of Dell EMC.
Yeah.
The largest employer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks for that.
Yeah. Wow. It's Dell EMC. The Hopkins yeah. Public Schools is the largest employer.
Yeah. Cheers to you, Superintendent.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a lot of advantage.
Thank you.
And you know, she knows everyone by name
exactly.
and stuff like that.
She did and a dog, right?
What she said.
Trying to.
Exactly.
We do have a dog.
Oh.
We have Lombardi. We now have our own dog at the high school.
Oh, you do?
We have a therapy dog.
I had no idea.
So
tell us
about that. Talk about that program, because I heard about this.
Sure.
I
so
did, yeah.
I think Evan Bishop really wanted to have a therapy dog full time. And so Mike Webb, who is a paraprofessional in that program, mm-hmm. Wrote a grant, and that's how we got Lombardi, the therapy dog.
Wow.
He's amazing.
So
I actually got to meet Lombardi the other day.
Yeah. So where does he reside, Lombardi? And what sort of dog is he, and where does he hang out?
So he is in our therapeutic program at the high
okay.
school. That's sort of where he hangs out.
Mm-hmm.
But he is not limited to just students who are in the therapeutic program.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. He you know,
free rein
gets out and about, and the kids seem to love him.
Now, who trained him, and where did you know, and who takes him home at night?
He came to us trained, and he resides with Mike Webb.
Okay.
That's
yeah.
awesome.
So,
yeah.
See
what you learn.
Are they shepherds or labs or?
He has a black lab look.
Yeah,
yeah. He's a very handsome dog.
Oh.
Yeah, he's lovely.
Did you guys get to name him too?
No, he actually came to us named.
Yeah.
I guess the agency that trains these dogs will. Do sort of like a raffle kind of thing so that they actually use it as a fundraiser.
Oh,
the naming
good
of the dog.
To name
that's
the dog.
Yes.
That's
yes.
great.
What I know Denise Hildreth was, I mean, I heard rumblings of this about a year ago and about the need for, and so I don't know if she was part of the coordination or just
advocacy you know, for it.
Yeah.
Yes, she does bring her dog. So she
okay,
was bringing in a dog one day a week.
Got it.
And it was such a hit, I think.
That's
one of the reasons why
okay.
we pursued having one full time. But her dog does come in still one day a week because the kids are still so attached
yeah.
to that
Aww.
Dog. Yeah.
Well,
you
know. Well, I know in crisis situations that she's helped bring dogs in, whether it was a wake last year and things like that. That and then you know, and I saw that it really drew the kids out and stuff like that. It was nice.
So that's cool. So now you have a full-time therapy dog. What
we
else?
Do?
What else is
new and different?
New and different in the schools.
Oh my gosh! Yeah, the turf fields are coming along. They are slated to be done the end of this month.
Mm,
so
okay.
yeah, it'll be very exciting. And
yeah.
if you take a ride back there, it looks like they're making
wow,
really effective
cool.
progress.
Cool. What about you know throughout? I mean those. I mean, just anything else new and different? We, the new elementary school, but any new programs or you know?
Well, you did a summer survey.
Oh, we did.
That?
Yeah. Oh, yes, that was hot topic.
So, that was a
just
hot
topic. Just for the
audience,
yes. a survey on diversity, inclusion, sort of interests or what was the theme of it, I guess?
Yeah, it was yeah. really about culture and diversity. When we look at DESE statistics, and you know, I know that these are very global, but if we go back to like 2013,
mm-hmm.
this community was probably 95% white.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And
mm-hmm.
you know, today we are under 80% white, and my guess is that
continue
that demography
change.
Will change
wow.
until we are a minority-majority district,
right?
Right,
right, right. right.
So that's something else that I think we need to think about. So this summer, the admin team was going to bring in Khalees Warrenham. She used to mm-hmm. be the Metco coordinator in Wellesley. I think she's mm-hmm. kind of fading from that and
mm-hmm.
mostly doing now her own professional development and consulting
work. The neat
work.
Thing about her, too, is that she was a Metco kid originally and grew
yes.
up through the program, so she knows hands-on
right.
how it feels and then now to teach it.
Yes.
yes.
And administer
and
teach it.
How it
so
feels.
What qualified.
I know. I've heard rave reviews about her from Wellesley.
Yeah.
Yes.
So you did...
We had her in this summer, and then she'll be joining us three or four more times throughout the school year. At the admin level, we have the ADL coming in to do work with the teachers in the middle school and the high school. So there's sort of a lot of that process. But last night at school committee, I did present some of the findings of the survey.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, because it went out to parents to students mm-hmm. to alumni to faculty and staff, mm-hmm. There are loads of responses, and then therefore I think, you know, there's an enormous amount of data there that we can kind of work through. And we did both qualitative and quantitative mm-hmm. data. Mm-hmm. But the results that we got were very interesting. And I think what I showed last night were the alumni results, because mm-hmm. I think that that one jumped out at me as, I guess, particularly salient. Mm-hmm. The alumni, we only had 37 people respond.
Okay. Yeah, I wish my kids had known. I don't know if they knew about the survey, but no, I understand what I'm just saying. Yeah, go ahead.
But I think mm-hmm. if we look at the demographics of the respondents, mm-hmm. Very largely they are people who would have fit, I think, into historically marginalized groups. Mm-hmm. Right? Okay. So there's a whole lot of voice there about what their experience was like. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I mean, I think that that...
That's a data point.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And the tough thing is, we all have unconscious bias.
Of course.
We all use stereotypes because it's a processing part of our brain. Mm-hmm. It's a way to shortcut it, and we do it. And so, you know, the challenge is how to make us aware of our unconscious bias, how to make us aware of our stereotyping, and realizing when we're doing it, and then trying to change our behavior and perceptions around it in how then we react, deliver, respond. Mm-hmm. And it's a challenge.
Sure.
I mean, it's not something that, you know, we all have it, so.
But your point around the survey was more, I was getting to the purpose of it for the schools. I mean, the information that you share, is it more for internal planning or just preparing or thinking about needs and future?
Well, I keep mm-hmm. saying that a good survey should generate questions.
Right.
So I think at, you know, in the next few months, we'll be putting together some focus groups to explore, you know,
what it meant.
Why are people responding in the way that they do?
Exactly.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Well, and hopefully it will result in some training and some,
well, once you,
you know,
debrief with people, because I'm a survey geek. I love gathering data, and then it's just interesting to see the results, and then what do you make of it as a group, and then you start fleshing that out, you know, kind of.
The faculty and the mm-hmm. students almost had mirrored responses to the question about if you had ever either experienced or witnessed some mm-hmm. insensitivity,
mm-hmm.
and at 30% they agreed that yes, they had done that, they
right,
had seen
right,
that, right?
Right?
So, you know, that lets us know that there might be some work to do there, right?
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes I think that, you know, when we talk about your unconscious biases and those things, sometimes I think that we just make comments unwittingly. We don't even know that they're insensitive
when we're making them. Yeah.
And
mm-hmm.
it's only through education
right.
that
right.
you overcome those right. pieces, right?
Right. Exactly. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Exactly. Very cool.
I don't think it was part of the survey, but it's something I'm just curious about. Is, as you've seen, like, the demographics change coming in, mm-hmm. have you seen a greater need than to address people coming in that English is their second language?
I can't even. So I think when I got to the Hopkinton Public Schools, which, you know, is only 2 years ago, the number of English language learners in our school was at 48.
Mm-hmm. 48 students.
48 students. And so at the start of this school year, we were at 153.
Mm-hmm.
And what happens is, in the first month of school, anybody who, there's a form the parents fill out, and we call that question the floaty question, your primary home language other than English,
okay.
right?
Yeah.
So if you check the box, we are legally obligated to screen that student.
Mm-hmm.
There are 220 students whose families check the box that they speak another language other than English at
wow.
home. And after
that's
we do that screening.
That's 8% of our student body mm-hmm. now, when you just said how many students.
Right, that's exactly
yeah, that's,
right.
That's a big
yes.
number.
Yeah. It is a big number. And
yeah, I'm a
usually, the yield is about 25% of those kids. So
yeah.
it's not unlikely that, you know, somewhere around 50, 55 kids will emerge this year as mm-hmm. students who need English language yeah. instruction.
Wow.
But you have to combine that with then the English speaking student who needs assistance with, you know, you have this multifaceted issue of learners that need extra help.
Mm-hmm.
versus potentially high learners that don't need extra help but have the language issue.
Yes.
And so, you know, you have diverse needs
mm-hmm.
and around a similar target.
I think Connie hit the targets. For what I've noticed is that a lot of these kids, and since my daughter was friends with a couple of them, they're extremely high learners.
Mm-hmm.
It was just a hurdle their first, like, few months was like,
from the language.
Look, yes. And honestly, they got it down wicked fast.
Yeah. I mean, then you have a differentiated fast. Group that maybe...
And they're coming in at different age levels.
Yeah. Yes, you know what I mean? Absolutely.
So it's not like, you know, you have a high learner in first grade, then a high learner in 11th grade.
That's a great point. So if we're thinking about kids in kindergarten, first grade, second grade, mm-hmm. they are immersed all day long right. in language-rich environments. mm-hmm. And teachers at those levels do a very nice job of bringing the kids together. I mean, they have, you know, community
numbers,
each other friend all day.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So
yes.
there is a community there. Mm-hmm. But what we see at the middle school and high school level is if you have two kids who are, you know, Mandarin speakers, you know, Telugu speakers, mm-hmm. Spanish speakers, they find each other,
mm-hmm.
and in some ways they isolate each other themselves, and they
right,
do
right.
that, but it's easy to do that because
naturally.
Of the nature of middle school and high school.
Exactly.
Right?
And in high
right.
school, the foreign exchange students do the same thing, where they pull
sure.
right into each other, but they are
yes.
also come here knowing yeah. English. That's kind of one of...
That's a surprising number. Like roughly, and you may not know this off the yeah. top, but there are a number of internet global students that come in as foreign exchange, mm-hmm. and that's different from when my kids were at the high school. I don't know that there was more than one or two, if any, mm-hmm. but now it's like a major program. And
yes.
Yeah.
I want to say they're about 20.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Mm-hmm.
That's very cool.
Yeah.
And there's a lot going on in the community. In fact, you're already starting back. The school nights are being planned. All these
yes.
things are off. A week from tomorrow is like Poly
Arts
and
Yay.
Hopkinton Family Day. And a week from tomorrow is also when people are saying farewell to Center School.
Yes, oh. September 15th.
Oh. Yeah,
farewell
so, I mean,
to Center School.
Yeah. That's a yeah. perfect time with Poly Arts. People can just sort of do
walk over
to Center School,
yes.
do the Poly Arts, head over to Family Day. I think they moved that to 3 p.m. or something. To
yeah,
staggered.
3 to 6,
mm-hmm. and then it goes on to...
Yeah. Well, the fireworks mm-hmm. and
music. I know like Sunday Outpost Farm will have the Bluegrass Band there.
Western Nurseries, you mean.
No, that Western
oh.
Nurseries is on this coming. It's tomorrow.
Okay.
It's Blues and Brews, and then there's a regional bluegrass band that has Larry Dion and things like that. That is actually this Sunday at Outpost Farm, and they play all afternoon. They do that annually, so it's kind of some fun stuff. It's kind of like start of fall happenings, but like me, I did not want to break away from summer yet. It's still
yeah,
too
we
hot.
Just got
a
nice
oh, look
degree.
At me!
Just got a nice degree.
Still
trying
to
have
any summer here.
Local shout-outs before we.
I think you know. The night before, next week's show, we'll have, you said, Pam Litchfield. We'll be talking about Poly Arts the next day and the things happening that weekend. I think, you know, the schools are tremendous, and I think we're very grateful for what
thank
we have here
you.
And for you coming
always.
On.
Oh, well, I'm grateful
thank
to
you.
Be here, so thank you.
Well, good
so,
outcomes. You know, yeah. you still have that to go, but we're proud of our kids.
Cheers.
Who
yeah,
cheers.
Thank
that.
You all.
Yes.
Thanks
thank
for joining
you.
Us. Thanks for
thank
being
you.
With
thank
us.
Thank you.
Cool.
Very nice.
Back to school.
Back to school.